Hello friends, I am Nisha Sharma, Associate Professor, Department of English. The topic under discussion today is a critical appreciation of Daya Pama's poem, O Great Poet. Mostly people are marginalized in the name of sex, religion, race and caste. Caste plays a major role in all the nook and corner of India. The four tiers in the world system are based on the profession the people undertook. The four tiers of world system are Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. Among the four tiers, Shudras, who are the laborers and service providers, occupy the least cadre. Communities that come under the four tiers of Varna are termed as Savarna. Dalit and scheduled tribes who do not belong to any of the four tiers of Varna system are referred as Avarna. These people are commonly called as marginalized as they suffered a lot in the name of untouchability. Many writers echoed their agonies. The famous Dalit poet Daya Pawar expressed the sufferings of Mehar community that he belongs to. In Marathi, the word Dalit refers to the Spahn. The term was specially coined to refer untouchables in 1930. Dalit literature refers to the works that talk about the people who were looked down by others. They faced many sufferings and spurned in the name of untouchables. Now this term also indicates Harijans, Mehar, monks, mallas, chamars and pulayas. The sufferings of the people are unimaginable. Daya Pawar was a Dalit Marathi novelist, poet and activist. His novel Balukta was an autobiographical narrative of the atrocities suffered by Dalits which shook Marathi society. The encouraging response caused him to write another book detailing the negative response he received from his Dalit community after the publication of Balukta. As is evident, his work, both poetry and prose, is concerned with revealing the horrors of the caste system and the cruelties inflicted on individuals by society due to this system. In his poem, You Wrote from Los Angeles, Daya Pawar shows his anger towards the people by whom the Dalits were suppressed and ill-treated. The poet feels satisfied by seeing the Indians being ill-treated as curs by the white people in a foreign land. He feels good that the same abuse was experienced by an upper class man when he is alive. The lower class people were treated as dogs. Now the poet feels relief and happy on seeing the Indians going to foreign land and suffering under the domination of white men. When the poet remembers the days of suffering under the upper class people, he feels like 1,000 scorpions stinging him. Now he feels like he has taken revenge on them, and so he feels satisfied. Now you have had a taste of what we have suffered in this country from generation to generation. Writing in the tradition of Dalit literature, Daya Pawar raised issues of caste inequality and oppression, as well as questions of indoctrination and literary value in this poem. And now to the poem, O Great Poet. The poem, O Great Poet by Daya Pawar, also talks about the sufferings of marginalized people. Here, Pawar attacks the great poet Valmiki, who is well known for his epic poem, Ramayana. Valmiki belongs to Dalit community, but Daya Pawar chides Valmiki that he failed to register the sufferings of Dalit community. He is angry towards Valmiki that he knew the plight and sufferings of his people, but failed to write a single verse in favor of the community that he belonged to. In Ramayana, Valmiki lamented for the death of Heron, but he hasn't written a single verse for Dalit people. Now, a deep insight into the story of Valmiki, the great poet. One day, the sage and poet Valmiki was walking through the woods and saw two herons engaged in love. The vision of the bird's beauty was beyond description. Then, out of nowhere, a hunter arrives, lifts his bow, and shoots the male bird with an arrow. The heron falls to the ground and lay dying in a pool of blood. The female bird let out a cry that was potent and illustrative of her agony. Upon hearing the sound of the bird's grief, Valmiki was pierced in the center of his heart. Valmiki, who had witnessed all that had happened, was filled with compassion. He involuntarily burst into poetic verse that seemed to flow out spontaneously without any effort on his part. O fowler, thou hast so cruelly killed the male of a pair of crotch birds while they revel. On that account, you will be discredited forever. Just as you ended the bird's life before its time, so too shall wilt your life before its time. Having uttered his versified curse, Valmiki became thoughtful. What has come over me? Why did I curse a fellow being? Was it my sorrow at the helpless wailing of a bird? Or does it have a hidden meaning? Born out of the pathos of a slain bird, some birds have escaped me without my conscious effort. They are so arranged as to follow a meter and a viable for rendition in the form of a song to the accompaniment of the string instruments. Hence, let it be known as a shloka. Reflecting on the events that had come to pass, contemplating on his poetic words, Valmiki reached his hamutis. As he sat with his disciples, engaged in the study of the holy texts, there appeared before him the most effulgent form of Brahma. The creator of the world and knower of the Vedas was endowed with four heads, so whose four faces facilitated the chanting of the four Vedas. Controlling his joyous soaring mind, bedazzled and awestruck at the glorious presence of the great Brahma, Valmiki bowed in reverential homage and performing all the traditional rituals worshipped him. The omnipotent Brahma, seating himself, asked Valmiki also to be seated. Even as the sage said, his mind was still lost to the thoughts of the death of the crotch bird. Unbidden, flowed thoughts of his own reaction to that tragedy, and he softly hummed the shloka which escaped his lips. Lord Brahma smilingly addressed Valmiki, saying, "What you have composed is undoubtedly a shloka, and those words emanated from you at my will. Compose the history of Rama, who is famed for righteousness, virtue, wisdom, and for his unshakable resolution, in the manner made known to you from Narada. In the epic that you are about to compose, there will be neither error nor falsehood. So do embark on the story of Ram, Lakshman, Sita, Bharat, and the Rakshasas. Their deeds and thoughts will all be made known to you by my grace. The story shall be composed in shlokas of the same meter which so haunt your mind. As long as the mountains and rivers remain on this earth, so long will the story of Rama, the Ramayana, endure. So long as the history of Rama lives on, that long will you abide in the higher regions, and as long as the Ramayana authored by you is remembered in this world, so long will you move in the nether world and in the Brahmalok at your will." The Lord Creator then vanished, leaving Valmiki and his disciples in a daze. This couplet of four parts, each part consisting of an equal number of syllables, attained a greater glory because of its repeated rendition. Valmiki, profoundly intelligent and capable of putting thoughts into action, resolved on the composition of the epic poem Ramayana, entirely in the meter that had divinely occurred to him. He then composed hundreds of charming verses, each containing an equal number of syllables and most excellently worded, meaningful and according to meter, with melodious sandhis and sentences composed of lucid, meaningful phrases, tells the story of Rama and the slaying of the ten-headed Ravana, the sound of which would delight the ear and the meaning of which would mesmerize the heart. The poet recalls the sufferings of Dalit people. They are not allowed to mingle with others. They haven't tasted happiness or seen colorful days in their life. Valmiki very well knows that his people are fighting for their freedom, but he hasn't written poems that talk about their suffering. So, Dayapama reprimands Valmiki that he cannot be considered a great boy. Dayapama juxtaposes the misery of Valmiki's life and background against his monumental work in which he glorifies Ram Rajya. By placing Valmiki's lower caste background and the atrocities suffered by his community and his people as a counter to the praises of Ram Rajya, Dayapama raises the issue of what it is to be a great poet. Is the quality of his verse and his thoughts what made a great poet? Or is it that poetry should be a weapon, a mode of protest, a medium to raise the consciousness of the downtrodden and express their pain? Pawar also speaks indirectly about the ways in which caste inequalities are strengthened and perpetuated by the indoctrination that colludes with outright oppression. The internalization of inequality and inferiority by members of the lower caste, which causes them to remain in positions of marginality, is also shown by Valmiki's reluctance to speak about his people and their problems, preferring to focus on a Ram Rajya, during which his own people continue to be outcast and oppressed. An instance of their oppression can be seen in the story of Shambhuka in the Ramayana. Shambhuka was a member of the lower caste whose head was chopped off by Ram for daring to attempt to read the Vedas. O great boy, how then would we call you a great boy? Had you written just a single verse exposing this injustice, this outrage, then would your name have been carved in our hearts? The poet also talks about the historically inaccurate slaughter of Shambhuk, who is a Shudra saint. Now, the story of Shambhuk. The story of Shambhuk has been mentioned in the Uttara Ramayana, which is supposed to be the last canto of the Valmiki Ramayana. There are many controversial stories inside this canto, and one school of thought is that due to these controversies, many won't consider this as part of the Ramayana text. One such controversy is the story of Shambhu. When Ram was ruling Ayodhya, a poor Brahmin approaches the court with grief and tells everyone that his young son died, and that is due to the misrule of Ram. Ram immediately calls a meeting with all the great sages and asks them, what is the cause of this? We have to remember here that he had sent his pregnant wife to the forest as he didn't want any blemish on his governance of the country. Narada, one of the sages who can see through the time, tells him that this issue is due to a rule of penance which was violated. Now, what was that rule? Apparently, in Treta Yuga, only Brahmins were allowed to do the penance. In Treta Yuga, two Varnas, nothing to do with caste, Brahmins and Kshatriyas are allowed to do. In Dwapar Yuga, three Varnas, including Vaishyas, are allowed to do penance. Only in Kali Yuga, all the four Varnas are allowed to perform the penance. Narada says someone from the Shudra Varna is performing a penance due to which the child had died. So Ram goes in search of that person who is none other than Shambhu. He tells Ram that he is doing penance to attend work with his physical body. So Ram slays him as he has violated the rule of penance. This has been, as usual, twisted by the people with vested interest by giving a caste angle, notwithstanding the fact that Ram considered Guha as his brother and gave salvation to Sabri. Both of them belong to the fourth Varna. As a ruler, he had to govern the land according to the prevailing laws. The fact that he had sacrificed his own wife is a clear indication that Ram, in that avatar, acted clearly according to the rule of the land, then going by his personal preferences. One should also note that even assuming that the text is part of original Ramayana, was written by a person who belonged to the fourth Varna. The poet questions Valmiki for writing poems for the upper class people. The poet finally ended the poem that if Valmiki had written a single verse for them, they would have carved his name in their hearts. In the poem Hiroshima also, Gaya Pawar compared people's anger to the atomic bomb blast at Hiroshima. Marginalized people are kept in separate place with which has no bright light. They long for love and care which are rejected to them. They are able to experience only the cruelty. They have none to guide them. They at times love out of their hearts, but their happiness do not last for a long time. It is quickly wiped off by the upper class people. They are given a place to walk which seems to be a meadow, but actually it is a mosque. They are left in an infertile place. They are made to stay in a small space where they feel like someone is strangling them. They long for good air, but they are choked to death. They do not even have freedom to breathe. The poet says that they are ready to die in mouths instead of suffering alive amidst the inhumane people of upper class society. The Marathi poet Daya Pawar has fumingly penned his torments as a Dalit under the suppression of upper class people. He expressed his pain in his mother tongue, and they are translated by various translators. Through these poems of Daya Pawar, which have been translated, the readers are able to empathize the pain of the Dalits. This shows that these poems were translated by efficient translators who are able to reproduce the essence of the poem. These poems are good examples for a good sense of translation. Thank you.
Well, they are very proud to say it.